Today I'll be discussing the reaction mechanisms of coordination compounds. The first thing to remember is that it is based on the transition state theory. So basically the reactant molecules, they collide with each other, and if they have sufficient energy, they form the activated complex or the transition state, which then decomposes to the products. This decomposition to the products can be in a single step or can be a multi-step process, which is dependent on the specific reaction under consideration. So when the reactants collide, the collision involves a lot of kinetic energy. This kinetic energy gets converted to potential energy, which is expressed as a change in the bond lengths or a change in the bond angles. So this conversion from kinetic energy to potential energy happens as we progress in the reaction. And the activated complex or the transition state is the point at which there is maximum potential energy. Then from that point, the activated complex, it rearranges or it undergoes some sort of rearrangement to form the most stable state, which is the product. So what we need to know firstly is, how do we draw a graph of this? So the obvious thing is the bond angles and bond lengths are changing, so they are the ones that are monitored. A graph can be plotted in which the y-axis is energy, potential energy to be more specific, and the other axis are the bond lengths. So let us consider the very simple reaction of HF H2 plus F. H2 plus F gives HF plus H. Okay. So if you consider this, which are the two bond lengths which are important? RHH and RHF. So as the reaction progresses, this HH bond will be broken and HF bond will be formed. So there will be a change in these two factors. So now if you want to plot these two with respect to potential energy, it will be three factors. So it will be a 3D diagram. This 3D diagram is also called a contour plot. And in this contour plot, the pathway which follows the minima of all the contours, that is, which passes through the valley of all the contours, is called the reaction coordinate. You will be able to see the contour plot in the PDF file which I have uploaded in the college portal. Do check that out. And you will also be able to see the reaction coordinate as a dotted line passing through the valley of all the contours. So that is the reaction coordinate, and it basically shows the minima of energy path. This reaction coordinate is what is used to monitor the progress of a reaction. Now the next question is, why do we need the reaction coordinate and why not monitor it as a 3D plot? Because this is a very simple reaction. All reactions are not this simple. In reality, if you have a molecule which is non-linear, all these molecules, H2 is a linear molecule and HF is also linear, so the bond angles were not considered. But the moment you come to a non-linear molecule having n atoms, you will have 3n minus 6 coordinates to consider. So if you have 3n minus 6 coordinates, the number of dimensions in which you'll have to plot will become extremely large. So that is not a very feasible or easy to do process. That is the reason why we use the concept of reaction coordinate. What is the reaction coordinate? The reaction coordinate is basically an average. It is an average of all the change in all the bond lengths and bond angles which happens as the reaction progresses or as the reactant gets converted to the product. Don't worry right now about the specific definition that is there in that PDF file which I have shared. Okay, so now the next thing that one needs to know is, we are clear about what the reaction coordinate is. Now this plot of potential energy versus reaction coordinate is called the reaction profile. Potential energy versus reaction coordinate. This is essentially a 2D diagram which can be very easily used to monitor the progress of the reaction. This is called the reaction plot. Now, the important thing that we need to know about the reaction plot is the fact that it can be of various types. What are the different types? The different types depend on how the energy is changing with the progress of the reaction. Now, as you all know that the intermediate is a the transition state is a point which is the highest energy point. So, there is no problem regarding that, but there might be one or more intermediates involved. So, if you have a reaction profile like this, it means that this is the reactant and this is the product and this is the transition state. So, this is essentially a saddle point which indicates a sudden jump in energy over and above the maxima. This is one type of reaction plot. You can also have a reaction plot in which you have potential energy versus reaction coordinate, and it is a humped structure like this. So this is the reactant and this is the product, and this indicates presence of an intermediate. Okay. So, this valley indicates the presence of an intermediate. The intermediate is of slightly lower energy, but it cannot stay forever. That is, ultimately it will finally form the products. So, this intermediate, another important thing is this valley, the shape of this valley indicates the characteristics of the intermediate to a certain extent. If this valley is small, if it is sharp, then it indicates that there is low entropy of activation and there is lesser space for bond stretching. If this is wider, it indicates there is more space for bond stretching in the reactants. Anyway, moving on. So, these are what reaction plots are, and reaction plots are essentially plotting of potential energy versus reaction coordinate. Now, moving on to the next important point, the specific point that we need to know is ligand substitution. Okay, before we move on to that, there's another thing that we need to keep in mind, that is the principle of microscopic reversibility. What is that? Why is that important? That is important because these plots are all basically an indication of not only the energy, but they also help us in mechanistic studies. So, the principle of microscopic reversibility states that at equilibrium, both forward and reverse reactions proceed at equal rates along the reaction coordinate. That is, at this point, there is equal probability for the intermediate to move in this direction towards the product or in this direction towards the reactant. That is what the principle of microscopic reversibility states. So, what is the utility of that? So, basically, when you have an exchange reaction in which you have a leaving group and an entering group, so if the leaving group and the entering group are both the same, then there's no problem. They will have similar rates of loss and entry. But if the leaving group and the entering group resemble each other, but they are not exactly the same, then using this principle, the principle of microscopic reversibility, we can say that the mechanism can be predicted because the loss of one will be similar to the entry of the other because of their similarity in nature. This you will understand more as we move on ahead in this chapter. So, let us move on to the next topic, that is ligand substitution.